I still don't understand legitimate case of rape. I mean, you know, there are plenty of women that are going to be listening to it and saying, rape is rape. Why add a moniker to it?
Well, and this, as I said, it's a law enforcement term. A woman calls a police station, the police investigate. She says, I've been raped. They investigate that. So before any of the facts are in, they call it a legitimate case of rape. That's what they
right.
call it. But they use the word just legitimate rape. So, but the thing is, it strikes me as odd is this is something that was intentionally misunderstood and twisted for political purposes. Because it doesn't make any sense to say a conservative is saying that rape is legitimate. I mean, that doesn't even add up. And so, but this is something that's done all the time in politics to destroy somebody's character. You make fun of them, and of course, right after that Sunday interview, yeah. Monday morning, very odd timing, Obama walks into a press yeah. conference, which he never does, and takes the question about right. Todd Akin. So that's kind of what's going on. That's a part of it.
Well, there's no doubt that politics played into it, but you played into this narrative. And I guess the other question, you seem to be, you're very upset at Republican elites that you believe were trying to drive you out of the race. I mean, they were very public about their attempts to try to get you to quit. They believe what you said was wrong. I know you want to be mad at the media and be mad at the president, but it's Republicans that threw you under the bus.
Well, that's true, and the book, Firing Back, has kind of got several different themes. The first one, because that's where you started, was a legitimate rape comment. That was then taken times of absurd extremes, having me saying things or believing things that I never said. In fact, they were exact opposite of what I said. And so, but my point is kind of interesting. So I misspoke some words. It was intentionally taken out of context. It's made into this great big deal so that I'm sort of a villain of the whole world. Now the point I'd like to make is go 2 weeks later. You've got the Democrat National Convention, keynote speaker, Bill Clinton, and
right.
Even setting aside the sworn testimony under oath of Broderick, who claimed under oath that Bill Clinton raped her, you still have countless other examples of Bill mm-hmm. Clinton being involved in assault on women or indecent behavior with women, and he gets an applause. Now, it seems like to me it's a Democrat war on women. Now, spin forward a little bit to the last month or two.
We
get to Hillary Clinton. Turns out she's representing a guy who's a rapist. She knows he's a rapist. He raped a 12-year-old girl. She
okay.
uses her influence.
Well, wait a minute. I understand. Yep. Look, I understand you want to. I've heard conservatives beat up on Bill Clinton and Democrats before on this, and I've heard this Hillary. This is still about you. This is still about you classifying rape in this odd way. I guess let me go back and ask you this. Should abortion be legal for somebody who has been raped?
Well, that gets to the heart of the question on that interview 2 years ago. And so here's the question. Should the child conceived in rape have the same right to life as a child conceived in love? That's the question. I'll say it again. Should a child conceived in rape have the same right to life as a child yeah. conceived in love? Number of people on my campaign that were children that had grown up that had been conceived in rape. They were helping me on the campaign.
So, well, which, by the way, also undermines your argument that somehow the woman's body shuts down.
Well,
so that
now,
you believe that's wrong. You now don't believe that anymore. Is that correct?
Well, first of all, what my comment was the effect of stress. I never said that a woman can't get pregnant who's raped. I never said that. Now, the media lied about that I said that, but I never said it. And that's why I'm talking about all kinds of absurdities. But I was simply talking about the fact that stress affects the statistics of people becoming pregnant.
You didn't say that. You did say, let me read the exact quote. If it's legitimate rape, the female body has ways to try to shut that whole thing down, which the head of the American College of Obstetricians and Gynecologists said, while chronic stress can may decrease a woman's ability to conceive, there is no scientific evidence that adrenaline experienced in an acute stress situation has an impact on ovulation. So do you now believe what the American College of Obstetricians says?
Well, look, first of all, I'm not presenting myself as a doctor. There have been 6 recent studies, and we can provide you with a footnote for those that say that stress plays has an effect on pregnancy. But again, that's really an ancillary question to the final question, which is, a child conceived in rape, do they have the same right to life as a child conceived in love? That was the heart of the interview question 2 years ago.
And you didn't answer. You didn't answer. I guess my question to you simply is, do you believe there's ever an instance that abortion should be legal?
I think that what doctors should do is to try to save life, okay? And as I earlier in that interview, I made it clear, there's a thing that's, I believe, called a tubal pregnancy, where the child has no chance to live, and the child will kill the mother if the child grows there. Mm-hmm. Now, I believe that what you do is optimize life. You save the mother's life. Your objective is not to kill the child. Your objective is to save the mother's life. I think that if you'd call that an exception, then that would be an exception. But the point is you try to optimize life, because I believe that little children are special.
Let me ask you this final question. You're doing this, your book's out now. Your book's out in an election year. You have a whole bunch of Republicans that wish you would go away, that believe you're a symbol of causing of their problems with the gender gap that I just outlined. Why do this now and make yourself a new issue in 2014 for fellow Republicans?
Well, Chuck, you know, the question is all of us, and certainly this is what I did. I was in elected office for 24 years. I was reelected many, many times in Missouri. And it's always been my interest to try to promote truth, promote the good ideas that bring the best out in people. And so what my book is, I'm talking about that. And one of the things going on in the Republican Party, and it's the party bosses, because I have great respect for a lot of the grassroots party people and many of my colleagues in Congress. But here's the problem. You've got Karl Rove and certain people in the Senate leadership that they don't believe anymore in the process of what we call a primary election. They think that the people in primaries in various states are too stupid to pick the right person. So they're putting a tremendous amount of Republican money into a primary, which is a bad idea, because one, you're wasting money. Two, you're antagonizing half the Republicans in the state. And that's what I've been critical of.
Sounds like you're running for office again. When?
No, I'm just taking one thing at a time. I'm very thankful for the 24 years of public service. I've written a book. The reason I wrote it's not to get even with anybody, but to try to present good ideas. And I think people find it interesting because there's a lot of human interest stories, fascinating account of September and other things.
Todd Akin, former Missouri Republican Congressman, the 2012 nominee for the U.S. Senate from Missouri. Thanks for coming on and sharing your views, sir.
It's a pleasure, Chuck, and best wishes to your wonderful audience.